Hey folks, this is Vince with Dad's Gaming Addiction, and welcome to the DGA Awards for 2020. In this particular video, we're going to be giving our top 5 board games that we played this year. That doesn't necessarily mean that they were released this year. These are just simply games that we played this year. And we're going to be doing a separate one, top 10 games of all time. And the reason I'm doing two separate lists this year is because I had a hard time going, well, I really liked this game that I played this year, but it's not better than this one that I've been on, that's been on my list for several years in a row. So I wanted to give the newer games that I've covered some spotlight and also touch on the games that I really liked. So that's why there's two lists. So top 5 board games that we played and covered this year. And I have my list. Idalee has her own list. So we'll be talking about our various games. Now keep in mind that we don't have photographic memories. So we'll be trying our best to remember the games that we're talking about. But yeah, this is going to be a brief overview of the games that we liked. So just hang in there and hopefully these will give you some ideas as to possibly, you know, what to get your loved ones for this holiday season coming up. All right, so I guess we'll get right into it then. I'll start with my number 5 board games that we covered this year. Mine number 5 was Fallout Shelter. And Fallout Shelter is a board game that is actually based off of the digital game Fallout Shelter. And the digital game Fallout Shelter, you have this underground bunker, kind of like in Fallout 3 and Fallout 4, where in Fallout Shelter, you're creating rooms and you're managing your shelter's power, your water, and electricity. And in the board game, it sort of turns it into this engine builder where you've got your own row of rooms and your opponents have their own row of rooms. Monsters will be showing up from time to time, and you're going to be using dice rolls to, you know, resolve a lot of these things just to deal with the RNG part of it. But overall, I kind of liked it because it was very thematic. It felt like I was playing Fallout Shelter, the digital game, because a lot of the items and the pets and the people on the various cards that you see, like the equipment and all that, is in the video game. So it's like, it feels like a good copy and paste from the actual digital game. It wasn't one of those half-done ones where, well, this wasn't in the video game, why is this in here? This doesn't look at all like Fallout Shelter. There's no neon green. And this game has plenty of theme. It has the neon green from, like, the rads from Radio. It even has that thumbs up guy that you see everywhere in Fallout. So, like, this game is definitely thematic. And I thought it was really good, and I enjoyed playing it. Do you have any memories of this one?
I do. Did you like the digital version or the board game version more?
That's hard to say. Mm. The digital version is a bit more streamlined. Like, I can jump into it easily, play it for 5 minutes, and jump back out. Just like with the, there's a mobile version and the PC version. I have both. I can easily jump into them, do something real quick, jump back out. I can drag people to different rooms. This game takes longer to set up because it's physical. It takes longer to play. It's one session as opposed to one continuous session. So I guess it depends on what kind of mood I'm in. If I want instant gratification, then I'll go to the electronic side of it. If I want a actual game that takes 45 minutes to an hour to play, then I'll play this one. Either way, I guess it depends on my mood.
I like this game. I wish it was co-op. I don't remember if there was a co-op version of it.
I don't think so.
No, but I liked it. It was okay. Getting the resources, though, and getting the resources and getting rid of monsters was kind of like pulling teeth. Mm-hmm. But I did like the way that the monsters could kind of stack up on you if you don't get rid of them soon. Mm-hmm. And they'll just take away one of your rooms completely. That was pretty cool.
Yeah, there was a bit of RNG in that. Because if a monster kept appearing and it went on one of your opponent's rooms or your rooms all the time, that would be a bit unfair. You can use your opponent's rooms, but you have to pay them a cost to that. And this is worker placement. So for those of you that like worker placement games, you may enjoy this. You're assigning various Fallout Shelter workers to these various rooms to get resources. And then you spend resources to get more rooms or equipment or what have you.
Yeah, all in all, this is a pretty fun game. So I liked it, and I like that your choice for this was number five.
I see. All right. Good. All right. So then, what was your number five?
Mine was unfair.
Unfair. What is unfair?
It's a theme building park game. And I actually chose this one over, what was it called? Meeple Land, I think it was called.
Meeple Land was a game that we covered recently, and I know you didn't like that one too much because I didn't you mess up like early on and it ruined your entire game.
I think I did. I didn't mind the tile laying aspect, but I think Unfair does a better job, and it has like deck building and cards and stuff. And you can kind of stick it to your opponents, which you totally did to me a little bit, like quite a bit.
Not
But it
me.
was fun. It was actually really fun to see that. And I'm like, oh, maybe I could do this too, either in a future turn or in another playthrough. But I really liked Unfair. It was pretty unfair.
Unfair, for those of you that don't know, is an amusement park builder with cards. The game includes several different decks of cards, so like themed. They're based around different themes. So you can have like a pirate theme or what have you. And you're going to mix two themes together, and that is your game. You can even include different mods. So like you can have it if you want your game to be less of a take that kind of game, then you can there's a big friendlier game style that you can play. But you're going to choose two themes, then you're going to find the two decks that match that theme and mash them together into one deck. And then you're going to try and build your amusement park by putting in various rides. I think you can have up to five rides, if I'm not mistaken. And then behind that ride, you can include features or what have you. So, like, there's the ride in the front, and then behind it, there's like things that could go on top of the ride to make it better. You could have, instead of a ride, you can have like bathrooms or I don't know, like stalls,
Facilities.
facilities, right?
Yeah.
So this is like a it felt like Dominion, which is a deck building game because of how many cards there were in the box, but it's not a deck builder so much as a this is actually an amusement park builder. But it was very fun. It took a while to learn. This is one of the more complicated amusement park builders that I've ever played. But I rather enjoyed it. There's just a lot of components to go along with it. There's random events that
Yeah.
pop up every turn or every round.
Employees, guest
Employees,
prices.
yeah. So there's a lot to it. And I don't know. I mean, I did like it though. I mean,
I'm
it
surprised that I actually kind of liked this one
really.
because it was pretty complex and I'm not big into complex games. I like them a little complex, just not so mind-blowing. And to me, this was a little bit mind-blowing, but it was so much fun. I think it's because I love amusement parks, to be honest.
Well, that's good. I mean, it's kind of like me and Star Trek. Like, if I see a Star Trek themed board game, I'm more than likely going to buy it, even if the gameplay is terrible because of the theme. Like, you know what I mean? I'm just that, like if it was My Little Pony, you would be all over it. All right. So, what else do you want to say about Unfair before we move on?
No, it was a good game, and I definitely recommend it to those that like theme parks, I guess.
Okay. That's fair enough.
Sure.
Okay. Number four. My number four was something I don't want to talk about too much. It was the search for Planet X. And I don't want to talk about it too much because, you might have it on your list possibly. So, I just will say that Planet X, the search for Planet X, I like hidden movement, hidden clue games. This is a game where you have to figure out where Planet X is, and along the way, you're trying to figure out what other spaces contain what. So, like, there's 12 spaces, and the iPhone app randomizes the location of everything, and you have to figure out, okay, space one is it a dwarf planet? Is it empty space? Is it Planet X? And you're using the clues that you find along the way to figure out where Planet X is, along with other things. You can submit theories as to like what you think is where, and if you're correct, you get extra points for that. So yeah, The search reply, I like that style of game. And it has that mobile app, so it makes the game cleaner to play
Yeah.
because some of it's digital. So I enjoyed it. So that's as much as I'm going to say because I'm sure we'll talk about it later. But yeah, my number four was The Search for Planet X.
Very good choice. Just saying.
I wonder why that is. What was your number four?
Mine was Master of Orion.
Master of Orion. So this is a deck builder of sorts, or what is it? You tell me.
Honestly, I don't remember much about it, but I remember having a ton of fun trying to collect the resources and using my cards to collect those resources and going up the track, down the track, up and down, and it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, each player has a hand of cards, and there's three resources that we're managing. I think there's like food and production, or I don't know, military, something like that. And you're using those resources to play the cards from your hand into your tableau. And I think you can have like four rows similar to that of Unfair, where you can only have so many rows, but you can stack cards on top of each other. And you're trying to get the most victory points at the end of the game, based on the cards that you're laying down. So you're going toward a particular strategy. There is some take that in this game where you can attack. Some of it is very basic, though. Like attacking your opponent is just an action that you can do on your turn. So, and it's an automatic win every time you attack. So your opponent loses something, like morale, I think it is. Morale is victory points, I think. So yeah, it's not bad. I mean, it didn't, it was as basic as it comes. Like it was definitely themed well, but like I thought it was, I don't know, like it was, I wanted more from it. It felt more like a basic tableau builder that could have been more, but wasn't. You know what I mean? Ma to be fair, Master of Orion, the recent remake of it, was pretty basic too in its digital form. Like compared to other 4X games like Stellaris, which is pretty deep and has other mechanics that other 4X games don't have. Like Master of Orion is pretty bare bones basic for a Star 4X game. So it doesn't surprise me that the card game is just as equally as basic, but basic isn't necessarily a bad thing either. So you liked the, what did you like better, the tableau building or was it the resource management?
I like the cards, honestly. I like the tableau building. I liked the resources that you can gain from the cards. That was pretty fun. I don't know, the victory points, the battling was like meh, like the insta wins of the battles was just like meh.
Yeah, that was kind of crappy, but
But everything else, I really had fun in, and I would totally play this again just because of the cards and the resource gathering. I've never played the digital game. I kind of want to play the digital game
Okay.
just to see.
It's a good entry level 4X game if you've never played a 4X game like Galactic Civilizations or Civilization. So yeah. All right. So that was your number four.
Cool.
All right. My number three was clicking, clicking, clicking. Little Town. Little Town is a cute and charming city builder of sorts, where, I mean, it's called Little Town, so obviously. But it's a shared board, so you're putting buildings down on this board, your opponent's putting buildings down on this board, you control buildings, they control buildings, you can put workers down near like forests and water spaces to collect resources, and you have to feed your people every turn. But you're also needing to collect resources like wood and stone in order to buy more buildings. And the buildings are randomly picked from a central pool at the beginning of the game. So you're not going to see every single building type with each playthrough. So it's each game is going to be slightly different in the way you handle it. Of course, there's a basic setup to where all, the same buildings are available every single time. But if you want a more randomized experience, there's that. And the game only plays over 4 rounds. So it's one of those light, casual city builder games. And I think the most complicated part of it really is just you've got these objective cards that you get at the beginning of the game, and do you try and go for them or not? Like, you know what I mean? So it's one of the more basic town city builders. It's very light. So I would say, casual gamer families that are overwhelmed by more more complicated games like Power Grid. It's, sort of city-based, and people that are more overwhelmed by that kind of thing, this is a good starting point for them. So I don't know. I found this to be really charming and still full of strategy at the same time. Do you remember this one?
I do. It was okay. I preferred Tiny Towns.
Oh, okay, Tiny Towns was yeah, that's roughly the same kind of game. I
Kind
remember.
of, it was like Tetris-y more, I think.
Right,
Yeah.
you're right. It's like a
But
4x4 grid, and you had to fit puzzle pieces or building tiles onto this grid.
yeah.
Right, I remember. Okay.
So I'm always getting the titles of those two mixed up, but I definitely prefer Tiny Towns over Little Town. I think it's okay. It's a bit too basic in my opinion.
Okay, that's fine. I liked it because it was basic. Like, this was a game that I would like to, sort of like Masters of Orion, it's basic enough to where I can play it, put it away. But I found this game to be more charming than, say, Master of Orion. Like, there was more thinking to it, more, I don't know, more charm to it, in my
I can see
opinion.
that.
Yeah. So I like this one.
It was okay.
Not your preferred choice, huh?
Not my prefer. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's because I wanted it to be bigger and to have maybe a bit more components.
Okay. So if the board were bigger and there were more buildings, you'd play it. Is that what you're saying?
I'd play it again regardless. You know,
Okay.
because why not? You
Okay.
know, it's a why not game.
Okay. Makes sense. All right. What was your number three?
Mine was Extranaut 2.0.
Extranaut 2.0. Now, I gave this game flack for being sort of a copy and paste of the first game. Like, even the rule book in the back, the text was duplicated. Like, I mean, yeah, I love that extra information that this developer includes all the time in the back of their manuals, but it was a copy and paste of the same information as Extranaut 1. So I gave it flack for that. But overall, you like this one?
I never played the first one. Maybe if I had played the first one, I would probably be so disappointed at the laziness of 2.0, which, you know, which stands to reason. But ha being like a super noob to Extranaut, I loved this one, the only one that I played, which was 2.0.
And well, in this game, you're building rockets, and if I remember correctly, you're building them from different, like, you have a hand of cards, and these cards represent different parts to your rocket, and you're putting them on there. You have to match, I think, all of the same company or something like that. I don't remember the rules off the top of my head,
Yeah, I don't
but
remember much about it except that I was kicking your butt. No, I'm just kidding. So,
that's why it's on our top five.
no. I swear that's not it. I don't even know who won, to be honest.
You did,
But
but go ahead.
did I? I don't remember. But I love this game. You get to build rockets. I thought that was so cool. There's a lot of RNG, though, to this, which could really hurt a player if
Yeah.
he's like way behind,
I
I
couldn't get the
think.
cards I needed to launch my rockets. Like, you need a certain payload size, like a certain rocket size. Different cards have different, like, there's a left fin, right fin, and different companies develop them. And yeah, like, I wasn't getting the cards I needed. And even with the way the game let you swap out cards from time to time, it still wasn't enough for me to get what I needed.
Yeah,
So I felt frustrated with that.
admittedly, if the gameplay didn't go as smooth and I didn't get the cards I wanted to launch my rockets, I don't know if this would be on my top five. I don't know because I wouldn't have gotten the full experience. I got the full experience, I think, of doing like this and this and that and this and this and that, launching rockets left and right. So I had fun with that, you know?
Okay.
And I would play this again, with the thought of, okay, I possibly would probably get stuck in a rut. But I would totally play again even with that in mind.
I
So
like the idea of the game, absolutely. Like, I like the fact that there are different missions that you're trying to accomplish, and you can accomplish, like, the small, medium, or large. Like, there's different tiers to the missions, so, like, but you have to build your rocket accordingly to the type of mission that you're going after too. So it's like you have to build your rocket around the missions that you're trying to complete. And you not always successful because, you know, trying to get those cards, like I said, can be a bit RNG. But yeah, it's a good game. I don't want to knock it. It's still a good game. I like it. I was just disappointed by one or two aspects of it. But all right. So that was your number three. My number two was It's a Wonderful World. I really like this one. I love the art on the cards. I love a good Splendor-like game, and I think the term Splendor-like is going to be in my vocabulary from here on out because there's a lot of engine builder games that I like that are typical to Splendor or like Splendor, and I have to use the term Splendor-like, sort of like roguelike. Anyway, so in A Wonderful World, you're trying to gain resources of five different types. There's also a rarer element that you can get. But anyway, you're building a tableau of cards, and what's cool is that your cards are dual purpose. Like, you can use them, you can discard your cards to get a resource of a particular color, or you can opt to build it with the resources that you have. But, you know, you have to sort of pick and choose what cards do what and what approach you're going to go after. And then your ultimate goal is to get victory points based off of the different cards that you're putting in your tableau, like which ones generate points for you, which ones generate resources. So it's a really cool engine builder, and I really like this one. And I think there's like a on the screen that you're looking at, on the left there's white tokens, and on the right there's red tokens. And I think you get some cards reward you victory points for every two of those you have, or something like that. So there's different ways to score points in this game, either flat out victory points or victory points for every so much of this that you have, and so on. Do you remember this one?
I do. I actually forgot about it for the longest time, and you just brought it up, and I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot about this one. But yeah, it was good. I liked it. I'd rather play Splendor, but I do like It's a Wonderful World. Like I thought it was a very good engine buildingy resource gem collecting game.
Would you play Splendor more because it was more simple, or because you just liked Splendor better?
I don't know. I liked Splendor better. I love that there's like contracts that you can try to get like those people
Those
on the side.
nobles, yeah.
Yeah. I like that. I don't know. Yeah, I liked It's a Wonderful World too. I do. It's not my top favorite top of game. Like there's so many other games I'd rather play, but I won't knock this one off like at all because it is a good game.
It's beautiful. I really enjoyed it. I really did. I love that each card has a different cost and they produce different things for you every turn. And I don't know. I love a good engine builder, and this one definitely is.
Yep, I
So.
agree. It's a very good, very, very good game.
Cool. All right. So what was your number two? We're blowing right through them.
My number two is Tiny Epic Dinosaurs.
Tiny Epic Dinosaurs. So this was a Jurassic Park builder of sorts. So tell me, what did you like about this one?
Oh gosh, this is just so cute. This was adorable. I loved the little fences that you can build, the little tiny dinosaurs. I love the research, the science that you can do. And I love that there's like you have cards that you can get to have certain types of dinosaurs in your park.
They're like contracts where you have to turn in like one red and two yellow, and as a result you get either money or something like that.
There's a steep learning curve when it comes to housing the dinosaurs and what they do and what happens if they escape. That's pretty steep, but once you get it, I love it. It's pretty intuitive. It really makes you think about placement of your dinosaurs, you know, and where they have to go. It kind of makes your brain like start racking. And I don't know, I love this game. It tickled every single fancy bone in my body. So
And it was like this developer, the maker of the Tiny Epic series, like Tiny, like I have yet to play a game of his that I didn't like, which is really good. And what's crazy is that there's a lot of punch here in such a small package. Which is you can say that about most of his games, the Tiny Epic games. So like the fact that all of this is in a tiny box is so good. Like that's just very well done.
This is definitely my favorite Tiny Epic game.
The research was fun. I didn't get to utilize that as much as I wanted to. I was more busy focusing on the contracts and trying to complete them. And I was also focusing on, what color dinosaurs am I going after? Since this is a worker placement, when my worker is at a place, I'm blocking you from going. So I was constantly trying to figure out, okay, I need to go here first because she's going to block me if I don't. This is one of those like Lords of Waterdeep moments where you can easily look at your opponent and go, this is what they need, so I'm going to block them. So, yeah, that there is that. I don't like to take that part of worker placement, but it's still a good game nonetheless.
I think this game still did it really well. Like, I don't like take that mechanics, but I think this game did it pretty well because there are quite a bit of options. There's ways to get around it with the whole you have to spend two people instead of one to go on the same space or a big person. I don't know. I love this little game. It was just so cute. I felt like I was in a tiny Jurassic Park manager world.
I would love a larger version of this. I mean, there is a couple of dinosaur games out there that are bigger than this, but I did enjoy this one. Yeah, good choice. All right. So that I guess that means we're on our number one then, huh? That was quick. Yeah, it's not typical of our top fives. All right. So top game for this year that I really enjoyed playing. Mine was drum roll. Fantastic Factories. There we go. So I don't know what it is about Fantastic Factories, but I really enjoy this one. I think Scotty, one of my Patreon supporters, actually recommended this one to me. And I bought it and I was very happy with it. There's so much that you can do in this game. It's another engine builder, surprise, surprise. But you're going to be, you're going to be drafting cards from this market so you can get like people or you can just draft various things like nuclear plants or gymnasiums, different cards, sort of like in Machikoro, kind of, sort of. And then you're going to be rolling dice and assigning dice to the various places. So you've got this little work area in front of you. You're rolling dice, and it's a worker placement at that point. You're assigning workers to various things. And then you're generating resources, like I think it was metal and energy or something like that. But your ultimate goal is to run these machines in your factory. And each machine does something different. Like this one might be exchange two dice of the same value to do this, and this gives you this, or give up a six to do this, or give up a two to do this. So, like, you're running your factory, you're producing resources. And this is another one of those games where the cards that you have in your hand also act as a currency because they have a symbol on them. So, in order to build a certain card, not only do you need the metal and the energy or whatever the resources are, the token resources, you also need to give up a card of that same symbol to build it. So you're constantly going, okay, should I give this one up to build this, or should I keep it? Should I try and draft a different card and give that up instead? So it was, I don't know, like it was meaty enough to satisfy that itch, and but it wasn't complicated, really. At least it wasn't for me. Do you remember this one at all? You
I don't
don't.
remember playing this with you.
That's okay. It's on video. It's clearly there. Unless I got you, I don't know.
No, I see it. Okay. I remember the dice. I remember the
Of
dice
course you
and
do. The dice is your
the dice.
that's your thing, rolling dice. You love rolling dice.
I vaguely remember the builder, the engineer, the researcher, and I don't know, the worker, the gear, I don't know. I remember those like assistant cards.
Yeah, the assistants help you do various things. They adjust the values of the dice to help you out. So when you're rolling dice, you can go, okay, I want to turn this die into this because my architect lets me do that. Or the foreman lets you increase or decrease the values of cards or what have you.
It's
So.
vaguely coming back to me. I think I didn't remember because I miserably lost in that one.
No, I don't think you did. You keep saying stuff like that, but our games are always very close, and you on occasion, well, not on occasion, regularly you beat me on these games. So you're one of those people that I don't know how how to play games. And then bam, 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 bam. Like, you destroy me. It's true. It is so true. You are one of those people.
No way. I think you...
Me? I'm such a noob. I don't know what I'm doing. Bam, 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 bam. Like, that's
how
your...
You
play and it's... I am wounded.
I don't know how to play... Like, I'm not that good of a gamer. I wish I was. But...
I am wounded.
Exactly. I'm so wounded. But, I think I somewhat remember this. I remember the dice can be converted and stuff into energy and power.
Okay.
I want to play this again. I don't remember too much, but I totally would love to play this again, man.
I have a feeling we will. I think there was a Kickstarter recently for an expansion. I may have backed it. So we will be playing it again at some point.
Okay.
Yeah. So... All right, that was my number one, Fantastic Factory. So yeah, special. Scotty's always laughing in his emails to me. He's like, "That's like three times now I've recommended a game that you really like." I'm on a roll. I'm like, yeah. So I want to give him props on the record right now that, you know, he does recommend a lot of good games. So thank you, Scotty.
Scotty's awesome. We have to like play a board game with him. One day.
I want him to come on my podcast at some point. We can talk about board games because he knows his stuff too.
We can play Tabletop Simulator.
Oh, there's right? that. Yeah, okay. Yeah, we could do that. Or Tabletopia.
Yep.
What was your number one?
My number one was your number four, The Search for Planet X.
The Search for Planet X. So, I've already talked about it. It's a hidden game where you've got 12 spaces on the board, and the computer randomizes it. You're trying to figure out where Planet X is. That's the main goal. But you also earn points for figuring out where other things are, too. What did you like about this one?
This is basically Space Clue.
Space Clue. Okay.
That I love this game. I love Clue games. I love, like, the logistics and the, like, okay, this is not next to this, but it is next to that. It is across from this, but it is not across from this. And I love trying to figure things out and having it make sense at the end. It's like a math problem. And this was so fun to play and trying to figure out where the planets were, like, before you.
You
like,
beat me at this.
In a mad rush, did I?
Yes, you did. You beat me.
Oh, man.
Our first playthrough, you beat me at. Yeah. So, yeah, that was good. I enjoyed it for the same reasons you do. Like, there's that mystery of what is here, what is here. And then you have action points that you're using. And certain actions that you take move you along the track. And the next person that goes is the one furthest back. So it's possible, like, you can take a bunch of low-costing actions and still keep taking turn after turn after turn, or do a really good action that gives you a lot of information, but you have to jump really far ahead, and your opponents can then take their turns for a while. So, like, there's some action point management to go along with this game.
Yeah, I want more games like this so bad, dude. There's not enough of those. What are they called? I think they're called, like, Einstein logic games.
Kind of, like Alchemy, wasn't it Alchemists or something? That was another board game that had an app, and you were trying to figure out what potion was what positive, negative, what I don't remember. But yeah, it's one of those hidden... Clue the Great Museum Caper, they're called hidden movement games. This isn't so much of a hidden movement game because we can see each other, but it's more like a Clue find the hidden stuff game.
Is that the one with the museum and you have to go through windows and doors and stuff?
That's where one person is the thief stealing paintings and the other people...
Yeah, I actually didn't like that one.
You didn't like that one? That's one of my favorite nostalgic games when I was a kid. Yeah.
I think that's probably the only hidden... Well, see, I consider that a hidden movement game.
That is a hidden movement game.
Yeah, but I like this. This is like a logic puzzle to me. You know, not a hidden movement, just like something's hidden, but you have to find it using clues. I guess that is a hidden movement game.
Well, no. I get what you're saying. It's not hidden movement. Like, it's not a movement game. It's more of a hidden figure crap out game. Hidden logic game. Is there I don't know. Is there a proper term for games like these in the board game world? Hidden logic game. How about that? We'll use the term hidden logic game until I am corrected in the comments.
Well, with this one, it's a static, like it's a static planet, and you are moving. You just have to figure out where it is. Whereas in a hidden movement game, the thing that's hidden is always moving and constantly, you know.
Active. One player is typically hidden while the other ones are trying to find them. Like, again, the Clue of the Great Museum Caper, there's Scotland Yard, there's Whitechapel, which is, like, Jack the Ripper themed.
Or that shark game that we play, the Jaws.
Jaws, yeah, that's another hidden movement game with some other things. But this game, we see each other. We're just trying to figure out where things are in the solar system.
Yeah.
You know, this sector of space is a dwarf planet. This sector of space is a gas cloud or whatever. And
I want a game like this with every single theme there is to imagine. Like, I think that would be
great. I like the hidden logic games like this. I really do. So, yeah, it's a good number one. I happen to like my engine builders better.
Yes.
But I totally like the Search for Planet X. That was a really good one. I don't back many games on Kickstarter, but I backed this one.
Oh, this was on Kickstarter?
Yeah, this was a Kickstarter game. I backed it and I got my copy like a year later. Wow. This was a long investment, but I finally got it in and I played it and I was happy.
What a great game. Mm-hmm. Like, this is actually a great game.
It seems like 60% of games now are on Kickstarter. Like, there's a lot of good games that,
Is it out of Kickstarter now?
Oh, yeah, it's been. Yeah, the fact that I got my copy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the fact that I got my copy, it's the Kickstarter's over. This is not a prototype that you're looking at. This was the finished product that I received as the result of that Kickstarter campaign.
Wow. What a great game. That was a good investment. Good job.
Yeah, I liked it. I couldn't pass it up. I like space and I like hidden stuff. Mm-hmm. So there you go. That was the DGA Awards 2020 top 5 games that we played this year. Again, not necessarily games that were released this year, but just games that we played this year. Unlike my video games, I only get maybe 5 to 10 free board games a year. So it's not like I have a whole lot of options, so I had to sort of make some sacrifices. But yeah, I mean, this was still a great list, and I do recommend that anyone check these games out. If I remember, I'll put links to all of these games in the below description. If I don't remember, then you can do a simple search. Look for my board games playlist on my YouTube channel, and it's all of the recent ones. I think I covered 40 or 50, 60 games this year, 2020, board games. And all of these were within that 40 to 60. Yeah. So there you go. The DGA Awards 2020 will be with you with some more videos here shortly. If you guys haven't already subscribed to me on Twitch and YouTube, that way you can stay up to date with any new content I happen to publish. This is Vince and Ida Lee. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you soon.
Bye, guys.